Security Breach is easily the biggest and most significant release FNAF has ever had. It's the game that really propelled FNAF as a franchise from a little underground sensation to more of a global pop culture phenomena that even the big boys of media should be envious of. But ironically enough, just about everything about the game itself and the events around it have been less than desirable, to say the least. And I think this has rung especially true in the 1 year since the game was released, so today we're gonna retrospect all about Security Breach, celebrate the fetal anniversary of this all. But before we get into the meat of this, I'm gonna say nothing, except that I'm gonna have a ton of FNAF videos on this channel in the future, so subscribe if you want to see any of them. And also, expect a much bigger, more thorough retrospective to come out after the DLC releases, so if there's anything I don't cover here, just wait. I promise I will soon enough. But anyways, let's get on with the video. So on December 14th, 2017, Scott rather famously finished off the main story for the FNAF franchise, really feeling that the series had outgrown him in his humble skills, and that it was time to start letting more experienced third-party studios give it the treatment the franchise deserved, starting off with the game FNAF VR in May of 2019. For this game, he chose one of the many VR startups out there at the time, Steel Wool Studios, a 20-ish person indie team out of California. Now, for all you who don't know, Scott has a rather interesting fondness for nepotism, meaning he tends to give jobs to people he has worked with before or really has personal connections with, even if they're potentially better people for the job. For example, take Scott's two main artists, Pinky Pills and Lady Fightsy, or some of the earliest FNAF fan art makers. Thus, Scott hired them early on, and they still do almost all the artwork for the series today, despite their subpar reputation and countless pleas from the fans to move on. But anyways, Scott obviously liked the little team at Steel Wool so much that he apparently decided to not only make FNAF VR the starting point for the future direction of the series, but also to flat out hire on Steel Wool to make a brand new AAA game that sure as heck seemed like it was intended to define the series for the foreseeable future. And thus, Security Breach was born. And after a few years of intense fan hype and several major delays, the game was finally launched last December, and oh boy. I think this game is fascinating because I feel like this game was based on a concept that was really bad, but done really well, but also done really badly all at the same time somehow. In truth, just as badly as Scott suffers from nepotism, Steel Wool really suffered from scope creep. The studio really was just an overly enthusiastic new team that was led by incredibly loose and generous leadership, who truly thought that they could make a world-class AAA video game unlike the world had ever seen before. All in their first non-VR outing, too. And to be perfectly fair, they came damn close to succeeding. However, as we all know, this game was just a little too difficult to ever meet Steel Wool's lofty ambitions. But that's not to say they don't succeed at some things. First off, I'm gonna give credit where credit is due and talk about the positives of this game. If you clicked on the video expecting me to bash the shit out of this game, good! Skip to the timestamp below. But if not, I hope you can enjoy my thoughts on some of the stuff I really liked about this game first. Also, realize if you find yourself disagreeing with anything I say in the video, just try your best to keep watching on to the end, as I think my views on a lot of things will become much clearer as the video goes on. But anyways, the game starts off with a tour of each of the animatronics' rooms, exposing us to all their individual personalities. Starting off with Freddy, then Chica, then Roxy, then Monty. I think that's cool because throughout the game we get to face these animatronics in almost this exact order, with the first parts of the game having Chica as the primary antagonist, the later parts with Roxy, then the final stages with Monty, although different gameplay choices can slightly alter the sequence of these events. And of course, there are several sort of spin-off sections and necessary detours sprinkled throughout the game too. You as the player have to navigate the massive open pizzaplex, sneaking and dashing around the animatronics while collecting room keys, completing puzzles, and even fighting boss sections throughout the game. Needless to say, but this game is a big deviation from the core FNAF series, but not just in the premise and gameplay, but also really in the tone and overall logic of this world. To address the most noticeable part of Security Breach, the game undoubtedly represents a colossal mood shift for the series, and I think the simplest way to explain this all is that, well, Security Breach goes from the more grounded horror background of the core FNAF series to a full-on cartoon universe. For example, the animatronics are incredibly anthropomorphized in this installment.
Vanessa, do not leave me like this!
With almost painstaking emphasis on the fact that each animatronic character is fully sapient, complete with their own thoughts, feelings, and emotions, and not to mention a physical range of motion and freedom that would even make Disney blush. And the way the game presents it, it all seems to be a normal thing in this universe.
Freddy, you're supposed to be on lockdown.
Officer Vanessa, I do not know how I got here.
And the funny thing is, while this should feel like a massive change in tone for the franchise, funny enough, it feels almost natural at this point, since the fanbase has already really made this view kind of the status quo, so it really feels way more organic than it has any right to be. Chica rehearses a performance, talks with the staff, eats pizza, then goes to practice guitar and unwind in her room after a long day? Yeah, sounds about right. But the funny part is, it actually kinda does at this point. And if you really think about it, this applies to the whole game, since Security Breach really is done from more of a fandom's mindset overall. I gotta admit, as soon as I saw the big alligator OC Monty ride in on the giant coaster, then proceeding to roar and slam his fists into the ground before the chase ensued, I have to admit, just a little bit of the 15-year-old fandom degenerate left inside me just squealed. This whole thing was just like something you'd read in a weird, awful Google Plus fanfiction thing, but damn. Somehow, they actually kinda made this feel good. Now, is this a shark jump for the franchise? Well, more like a fridge nuke if you ask me, and I personally wouldn't advocate for this direction. But for now, I really just gotta admire how they made this all feel surprisingly natural, even if it was technically a step in the wrong direction. Like I said, Security Breach is just so, so wrong in so many ways, but somehow, in so many ways, it feels so, so right. I mean, it's crazy, because at this point, most people don't even care if the animatronics are haunted, AI, both, or neither. To them, they are just characters. And I really feel that's how the game sets out to present them as. But apart from the deviations, one thing I can certainly appreciate is that the mood and style of this game does continue the series norm in the sense of being pretty frighteningly original. There really is nothing else that looks or feels anything like the games in this franchise. At least nothing that isn't a knockoff, that is. Now make no mistake, I'm in no way saying that FNAF shouldn't take some cues from the traditional horror approach. I think quite the contrary, in fact. But the fact that Steelwool has somehow managed to continue the franchise trend of a crazy unique style and feel is very impressive to me. The original FNAF game presents itself as this kind of exaggerated satire of the fast food and entertainment business, presenting Freddy's as a morally bankrupt, poorly maintained corporate chain that would ironically rather cover up the deaths of their employees and put up expensive fire security doors than spend any extra cash fixing up their main attraction. And that theme continues in one way or another throughout the rest of the franchise. But for Security Breach, the game loses most of that satirical edge, and just really fully embraces the childhood nostalgia element.
We can finger paint, tell stories, drink fizzy pies until our heads explode, and then stay up all night!
This isn't some greasy, cheapo place that couldn't care less about its customers and employees. This is a literal paradise on Earth. And now, with just about everything in this game, this whole change in approach weakens the lore a bit, and definitely creates some story problems. But in terms of pure feels for the pure game, this is a literal childhood dream come true. The intention to detail in the Pizzaplex is pretty dang incredible, since just about everything about its material and its design just feels so real. And as over the top as the whole concept is, from a purely design standpoint, this actually felt like a place that could really exist. The childhood nostalgia element that the game aims for is also pretty friggin' incredible overall. I'm not gonna lie, my time in the game rummaging through the ball pits, kicking around furniture blocks and hiding in the pirate ships almost got me teary-eyed at times. I mean, this game will give you some serious feels. I really feel like the original FNAF represented your childhood as it was, whilst FNAF Security Breach represents how you always dreamed it to be. One thing this game also hits bullseye on is the feeling of being a kid in a big arcade. Everything just feels so massive and even disorienting at times. And I think a cool factor of Security Breach is that everything in the game is really scaled up and exaggerated to represent what a big arcade felt like to you as a kid. And honestly, it's pretty brilliant if you ask me. And before y'all run to the comments, I'd know that there were some big problems this caused for the game. But trust me, we'll get to that later. Speaking of the feels, the music, mood, and aesthetic of this game are pretty friggin' awesome too. This game has a sort of modernized 80s theme that takes the authentic 80s feel and really revitalizes it with a contemporary, neon synthwave feel. The music throughout this entire game series has been pretty amazing, and this game is no exception, from the main theme to the boss battle music, to just the general ambience and background. Security Breach succeeds in beautifully completing the mood of every section. Now, the question of just how much of this warm, nostalgic synthwave feel the game really was intended to present to the players is a story we'll get to soon enough. But moving on to the gameplay. Now, I feel like when this game was being teased, everyone thought that this was gonna be just Hello Neighbor but with a FNAF skin, myself included. But instead, we actually got a fairly innovative, stealth Metroidvania hybrid with a pretty unique approach. And I have to admit, as much as I overall dislike this game, the base gameplay is something I will defend until I die. And if you think about it, the whole game is a rather clever approach to adapting FNAF into the third dimension, with much of the game revolving around you having to use a camera system to monitor the animatronics and learn and adapt to their patterns and behaviors. But now, with a new navigational element added to it all, with the player having to use the game's stealth and Metroidvania core to navigate the Pizzaplex, dodge all the animatronics, and access new areas and abilities. And I think that the concept of fusing stealth with Metroidvania gameplay and making pathfinding a puzzle in itself wasn't just good, it was pretty friggin' brilliant. In a traditional Metroidvania, the only way to really plan routes would be to follow the map and explore corridors and open areas, just hoping to find doors and pathways. But in Security Breach, you have the cameras to show you the different areas of the Pizzaplex. Too easy, right? However, the cool part is, you still need to figure out how to get there alive, all while avoiding your animatronic foes, which just so happen to be invincible enemies with a one-shot KO. And thus, the game is just as much about strategy as any other FNAF game is. With each area, you need to find out the mission objective, determine a room with the cameras to figure out where you want to go, and then finally flip through all the cameras to figure out just how you can get there safely. And of course, when it's all laid out like that, it sounds really tedious and complicated. But in reality, it really is one hell of an exhilarating experience, especially since you gotta adapt on the fly when your plans inevitably start to crack open. Spend too much time hiding and planning? You get bored. You just keep making mad dashes without any plan or strategy? Well, then you just keep dying and get frustrated. What I'm really trying to say here is, the game really encourages you to find a good balance in between. And even then, the excellent tension of the game and its overall punishing nature really makes sure that the player being too careful is still more fun than the player acting too reckless. Unless you just want to screw with the shitty AI and break animatronic ankles. But needless to say, I really think the use of cameras here for route planning is genuinely innovative, even if the game doesn't make it exactly clear that you should use them for that purpose. But that's neither here nor there in this part of the video. Also continuing the FNAF traditions is the fact that this game is also wicked hard overall, but generally in a good way, I think. The fetch quest system in this game I think is also done pretty dang well. The idea of getting different level security badges to get past the doors I think is a pretty genius idea, and also feels pretty realistic overall, compared to like getting a special beam or an ability that lets you hop a wall or something like in most games. If you want to navigate a giant mall after hours, you're gonna need employee keycards, and not all employees are gonna have the same clearances. Simple as that, really. And speaking of keycards, there are a whopping 10 levels of security clearances in the game, and like 7 big ass floors total in the Pizzaplex. I think people really tend to forget just how ambitious this game actually was. You gotta remember, this game was intended to be as AAA as it gets, with a massive map, tons of detail, advanced character AI, next-gen visuals, ray tracing, a fat-ass map, you name it. And while it's no secret that a lot of this really wasn't achieved, it's still rather impressive to me just how much of it was. But going back to the earlier point about the main gameplay sequences revolving around each of the main cast members, I'd say that while all the main sections are generally good, the Roxy sections of the game were by far the best character sections to me. While the main Chica sections tend to be mostly chase sequences and light stealth overall, the Roxy sections are always full-on stealth sections, usually with tons of hiding spots too. Make no mistake, there is little outrunning or staying quiet with Roxanne. You just need to huddle up in whatever hiding spot you can, carefully monitor exactly where she is, and then figure out exactly where she'll go next, and just sprint to the next hiding spot. Honestly, it's super tense, and she actually feels like a huge threat to the player. And that's to say nothing of when she is shattered. That exact following section with Shattered Roxy, I'd argue, is the tensest and most scary section of the entire game. It really is a perfect inversion of exactly how you had to deal with her before. Now, there is nowhere to hide, and the cameras are mostly useless. You just gotta move step by step, carefully picking where each next step is gonna land, just praying to yourself that you can somehow make it to a place where she'll have a hard time following you. Another cool thing about these sections is that distractions also play a big part of these levels. So needless to say, I really think the Roxy sections make the best use of the Security Breach game mechanics overall. Now granted, if we're talking about the best parts of the game overall, those parts of the game are undoubtedly the special sections, but we'll talk about those in a minute here. But purely from a gameplay standpoint, I really think the Roxy sections are the cream of the crop. But going back to an earlier point about the difficulty, the funny thing is, nobody could really agree on what sections of this game were the hardest, save for maybe the post-game section with no saves allowed, and the level that shall not be mentioned. For example, for me personally, the DJ Music Man section was genuinely Dark Souls level hard, but for others, they finished it in 2 tries. For me, the Moondrop Daycare Escape section was actually quite easy. Hell, I finished it in 1 try without any flashlight battery. but for others, it took them literal hours to beat. This variability in gameplay difficulty experience, I think, is an excellent example of a game that just isn't well playtested enough. For most games, there would be solid documentation on just how well each playtester performed on each level and section, and then those playthroughs and experiences would be used to balance out the game. However, here it was pretty obvious that the difficulty was mostly based on how well the devs did on each section, as well as what little contributions their tiny QA team could muster up. Which I think leads us to a bit of an elephant in the room. Mazer Size is a genuine game killer, honestly. It's a puzzle that flat out gives you false instructions, has an atrocious interface, and is just too damn complicated to ever feasibly figure out on your own. Mazer Size is so damn impossible, in fact, that the only way anybody got through this fucking puzzle was either with a walkthrough or just flat out painstakingly stacking objects to cheat the system. And when a puzzle is genuinely more enjoyable to cheat or to bypass than to solve, then needless to say, you've really failed at designing a puzzle. But for now, back to the positives. The thing is, so many aspects of this game are just downright excellent. The voice acting in this game is pretty friggin' phenomenal overall. I actually thought it was gonna be impossible to beat Sister Location, a game with voice acting so good, it actually got nominated for the voice acting equivalent of the Academy Awards. In case you don't fully grasp how crazy this is, a FNAF game was nominated against competition like Pixar's Cars 3.
I'm curious what events would lead a person to want to spend their nights in a place like this.
For a little niche indie game like Sister Location, this is insane. But yet, somehow, Security Breach manages to improve on the voice acting. Quite drastically, in fact. Everybody in this game gives a top-notch performance, and they deserve every ounce of recognition for it.
Do not return. It will never be safe.
But to me, in many ways, this really is the Kellen Goff show. Security Breach showcases his downright incredible voice acting range. From Glamrock Freddy,
I want to make sure you are not confused,
to Sundrop and Moondrop, Kellen really manages to steal the show. The latter, I think, is especially impressive, as he somehow manages to almost perfectly differentiate three very similar voices from each other in the exact same game series. And all of this was really crucial to bringing the characters of Security Breach to life, and it worked damn well too. And speaking of the characters, while I thought the characters themselves were very silly in concept, in the game they are actually really friggin' well done. Not just from a design standpoint, but they have surprisingly good personalities. I think something that's very interesting about these characters is that they all seem to be struggling to deal with very basic human emotions and feelings. Like Roxy, struggling with self-consciousness, Chica with hunger, Monty with anger and jealousy, and Freddy with just basic compassion and empathy. Which brings many interesting questions about their origins. But Lorhins aside, I really think the game tries its best to just present them as regular characters, so for now, I'll just treat them as such. And while I already talked about the excellent music of this game, I really feel like the sound design here needs a special shout-out. Every moment of this game keeps you on your toes due to an incredible ambience, and I do mean it when I say every event and close encounter with an animatronic strikes straight into your heart, just due to the outstanding sound effect work and the incredible directionality that these sounds present, whether it be the soft clanking of metal in the background, the hard clanks of animatronic footsteps, or even just the sounds of the player breathing. The sound design really deserves much of the credit for making the good in this game, well, good. Best yet, I think, is the way that sound interacts with the camera. With every clank or sound of importance, the camera just shakes in accordance with proximity and threat level, giving every encounter of the game some quite frankly amazing weight to it. And moving on to the visuals of this game, now, I'm not gonna act like the graphics here are terribly groundbreaking, because they really aren't, but they do make some notable use of next-generation techniques. Don't expect to see a single sharp polygon or pixelated texture here. If the game doesn't break, that is. As these are rapidly becoming a thing of the past with this new generation, the lighting I'd say would be the only exception to this rule, but trust me, we'll get to that topic soon enough. The animations in this game are also really well done across the board. You gotta remember, some of Steel Wool's founding members worked at Pixar at one point or another, so they're gonna have pretty high standards for animation. Although, like with the rest of the visuals in this game, they're far from groundbreaking per se. But anyways, back on topic. About those special sections that I mentioned earlier, I think we all know why these are the best parts of the game. The Joy of Creation endos are a wicked cool throwback to the original horror of FNAF, with withered and incomplete looking robots stalking you in claustrophobic spaces, moving only when you're not looking. It's a crazy fun and crazy scary deviation from the main game that beautifully shows that FNAF isn't afraid to take influence from some of its greatest fan games. Similarly, the Garbage Disposal Chica level puts us in a new and beautiful macabre take on Security Breach. It really is the perfect fusion between conventional video game horror and FNAF's more unique take on horror. I mean, the raw mechanical horror of the mutilated Chica just trying to squeak out words through her broken speaker, and the way she just sprints at you at every sight with every bit of her malfunctioning strengths still gets me to shiver while thinking about it sometimes. And that's to say nothing of the level design itself, since it's already top-notch, being easily one of the best in the whole game. And as mentioned before, the Shattered Roxy section borders on stealth perfection. Nothing more to say, really. It's just amazing. And last but not least, the Moondrop fight is just every child's nightmare come to life. The daycare section was already fantastic before, and this just seals it with an amazing conclusion. If you can get past the notably broken AI in this scene, the level itself is an amazing take on twisted nostalgia. All of these scenes aren't just unique, but overall friggin' scary. These are the parts where Security Breach drops the bright, cutesy aesthetic and pays homage to the gritty magic of the original FNAF series. But even then, Security Breach shows that it can still make magic with its own unique style. One only needs to zap aliens while dodging Chica and Phaser Blast, or collectively shit yourself when you pull the first level and the bass suddenly drops in the incredible DJ Music Man boss section to know that this game can more than hold its own weight in its own style. But now, with all credit given where credit is due, I think we are getting to the part that you have all been skipping ahead for. The negatives. Starting off with perhaps the most well-known problem of this game, the technical issues. Yikes. There's just not many ways you can exaggerate how bad of a game this was at launch. This game was genuinely a softlock simulator. It was actually impossible to beat this game without getting softlocked at least a few times. This is one of those times where the internet didn't overreact to a bad release. This was a time when they really underreacted. Security Breach was genuinely one of the most broken games I have ever seen, much less had to experience on my own. It really does land up there with Driver 3, Cyberpunk 2077, Fallout 76, Battlefield 2042, and now Pokemon Scarlet and Violet is one of the buggiest and most unfinished AAA releases in history. And I do mean that with full confidence. Trust me, while this game might not look quite as buggy as the aforementioned games, just due to the fact that the animations and collision detection is comparatively well coded in terms of raw gameplay experience, trust me, Cyberpunk and Battlefield may have been bad, but trust me, at least these games weren't bricking computers that tried to play them. Keep in mind, most people flat out couldn't even play the game past the opening cutscene at launch, and softlocks made the game nearly impossible to play for nearly a week after launch. And even then, many, if not most people, still couldn't get the game to actually run on their systems. For me personally, if I didn't have to do some downright crazy rigging and workarounds to try my hardest to optimize this game and to physically cool down my computer while playing, it actually would have ruined my computer. I could only run this game for 30 minutes at a time, and that was with external cooling devices and leaving my friggin' window open so that the nighttime winter air could freeze the friggin' place over. I cannot emphasize enough. As good as much of the game was, actually trying to play it anywhere near launch with all the technical issues was an absolutely unreal experience. There is no hyperbole that can be applied here. And even then, if we're just talking about raw playability for the game here, it took the game almost 6 months to be playable without having to restart large chunks of the game due to softlocks. And even today, with most of the crashes, bugs, and compatibility issues fixed, the game is still in a pretty damn rough state. The lighting is still really cut back compared to what we were promised. The animatronic AI still sucks, and now there are these really awkwardly placed loading screens just to keep you from falling through the fucking floor when entering a level. Wait a second, didn't Metroid Prime have a solution for this 20 years ago? But hey, at least you can skip cutscenes now, right? Yup. But now they take just as long to skip as to actually watch the cutscene most of the time. So you could have pretty much gotten the exact same effect if you just closed your eyes for 20 seconds. And that's not to mention the fact that 99% of the cut content and unfinished features of this game are still, well, cut and unfinished. And speaking of the cut content, oh boy. It's little exaggeration to say a third of this game was cut, and there were cool features cut, and some of them had glaring last-minute substitutes crammed in instead. Just for time's sake, I'm gonna list them out here real fast, but just know, I'm barely scratching the surface of this all here. But even excluding the massive amount cut from this game, what we were left with was still pretty damn rough most of the time. If you're not getting softlocked in this game, or just flat out falling through the floor, you're probably just gawking at the raw amount of bugs and glitches throughout the Pizzaplex. I think my favorite glitch of the game was when Backstreet Streams hopped out of Freddy in Phaser Blast, which somehow unloaded the game, causing him to fall through the floor until he reached the server room under Phaser Blast, which then allowed him to simply run upstairs and get the Vanny ending. Holy shit. The map in this game also really sucks, which is really interesting to me because what's obviously the biggest inspiration for this game was the Metroid Prime trilogy, which in itself had an amazing 3D map. So I really feel like this game used a beta map that just never got finished or replaced. So needless to say, this game is a very strange mixture of rushed and polished. I mean, the core gameplay and quests are very polished and clean, but just about everything else is just so unfinished and broken. And with regards to the gameplay, I still stand by the fact that I love the core gameplay. But if I have to talk about my feelings about the rest of the gameplay, montage time. The last minute lighting change really sucked the horror out of most of the game, and is largely responsible for the game's navigation problems. There are not nearly enough hints in the game to use the cameras to plan routes, which is a little bit of a problem for a game that revolves around route planning. As mentioned before, the animatronic AI is downright terrible. Animatronics are always getting stuck on obstacles, and the animatronics are always teleporting all over the place. The world is massively detailed, but at the same time incredibly empty, lacking in nearly all of the secrets and features you'd expect from a FNAF game. Again, the playtesting is terrible here. Having to figure out progression for some is a breeze, and a nightmare for others. The camera controls aren't remotely optimized for game controllers, and navigating them on console can be a flat-out nightmare. The collectibles are flat-out useless in this game, except for one lame ending, and aren't even interesting enough to want to collect most of the time. The flashlight mechanic was made overall useless in most sections after the last-minute lighting change in the game. Is this good? Is this bad? A mix of both? You tell me. The main villain of this game is almost completely pointless, and literally appears like twice in sections she obviously wasn't meant to be in, and her original voice was cut very late in development for whatever reason. The save system of this game just loves to overwrite good saves, and it took them ages to finally fix it. Several sections of this game are just too damn vague overall, like the luring Chica into the trash compactor section, or finding the staff bot head, and that's not to mention the fact that Mazer Size flat out doesn't work if you do what the game asks you to. The level design often literally leads you behind obstacles that you just cannot cross back over, leading to, you guessed it, more soft logs. I can't even. Freddy may be a really cool novelty, but unfortunately, he really doesn't do much in the game besides get you out of rough situations in a pinch. I think the staff bots were a really clever solution to an obvious flaw in Security Breach's game design. The fact that the Pizzaplex was so big, but there were only a few animatronics there to chase you. However, the staff bot jump scares do get old after a bit, even if they're arguably the scariest jump scares in the game. And I also think that leads us to a more controversial element of Security Breach's mood and gameplay overall, the horror. When this game was being teased, it really seemed like this wasn't going to be a horror-focused game. But funny enough, now that we've actually got to play it, it absolutely is. All the level design, music, mechanics, and art design are all firmly based around, well, horror. If you listen to the interviews with Steel Wool, it becomes all the more apparent that horror was number one on their mind when designing this game. The problem is, for most of this game, it just really doesn't succeed as much as it needs to. I've noticed a lot of people saying Security Breach is not really a horror game, but is more of a thriller, and I think what people are really noticing here is the very noticeable lack of grit in this game compared to previous entries in this series. I mean, people will readily say that Hello Neighbor is a straight horror game, but still think that Security Breach isn't one. And honestly, for decent reason. FNAF's grit really is a defining feature of this franchise. Without it, it just loses most of its identity. And no matter how much effort was put into the scares for Security Breach, it will just never seem scary in comparison. And that's not to mention the fact that, yeah, this game is just dumbed down a ton overall. FNAF is a gruesome fucking franchise, and even if most of it is off-screen, even then, this is still a massive downgrade overall. FNAF went from Scott's proof that he could make something dark and scary to a literal kids franchise real fast, And that's not according to me, that's according to FNAF itself. I'll make a whole video on this at some point. But in the meantime, after you're done watching this video, I'd highly recommend the video, Horror for Kids and the Problem with Indie Horror, if you want to see more on this topic. And not just the video itself, but make sure to scroll down into the comments as well. It's crazy how good most of the takes are down there too. And the funny thing is, I was under the strong impression that the majority of the FNAF community just didn't really care about the horror aspects of the franchise, and instead really only cared about the colorful characters and unique aesthetic. And as a longtime fan, who was as balls deep into the fandom as one could possibly get when the original series was running, I absolutely believe that was once the case. But things have really changed a lot since then. Nowadays, I see the same people that have devoted their lives to posting cutesy security breach fan art TikToks and gotcha life ships are now posting friggin' FNAF VHS compilation. And once upon a time for the FNAF community, these things would have been pretty dang mutually exclusive. But finally, for once in FNAF's history, in recent years, I really think the true horror aspects of FNAF are finally being appreciated by the fandom. To quote the famous saying, you really don't know what you've got until it's gone. And I think that strongly applies to the FNAF fanbase at the moment. I'll be perfectly honest here, I was never excited for this game. I, like countless others, really fell off after the lore really started to decline after FNAF 6, and from the start, I really hated the direction this game was going in. However, after starting to play the game, I was initially really impressed by it. While I really think most people nowadays would agree that the style and direction of the game was the wrong choice for the franchise, I will admit, I was still too harsh on the idea initially. Looking back on it, yeah, the trailers were really friggin' cool, and the premise of the game did look pretty friggin' fun. But reversing course a bit, even if I was way too judgmental in the trailers and premise, the truth is, from the start, I always saw the cracks in the making. And honestly, against all that I genuinely expected, now it seems everyone else does too. I think the bigger problem here though is, if there were cracks in the trailer, and the whole ass game is just fractured glass, Steel Wool has talent. Make no mistake, I don't just love the things this game does well, I friggin' adore them. And that's as a guy who thought he was gonna like nothing about this game. And now, I'm sure many of you are asking, just why? Why did the game end up this way? Well, to start off, like I mentioned earlier, Steel Wool was just an indie VR studio. They were way too eager and ambitious for their own good. And Scott, having formed a personal connection with them, just put too much faith in such a big risk. From what we can garner, it seems Scott gave Steel Wool a massive amount of creative freedom for this game. Scott also apparently knew that Steel Wool was biting off more than they could chew. But even then, Scott obviously still had faith in the team, and liked what he saw enough to give Steel Wool the leeway they wanted. Steel Wool took on a modestly sized project and just kept adding and adding to it. Steel Wool was the one who made all the huge expansions to the game, and then the massive changes to it late in development, and then forced themselves into a crunch to finish it. That's right, with all the information we have, it really seems like the crunch was self-imposed. Contrary to popular belief, despite what salty kids say on Twitter, there is no evidence that Sony Entertainment or any other company for that matter had any power to put pressure on development. The sole publisher and rights holder for this game's development was, well, Scott. And he gave the game major delays and large boosts in funding at almost a whim. In a shocking inversion of what's typical in the gaming industry, it seems that the only pressure to scale up and release the game was from inside the studio itself. Wait, so you're telling me that Steel Wool intentionally released the game unfinished, after putting themselves through a massive crunch to upsize the game, and then deciding to overhaul it just 6 months before release? All with almost unlimited time, freedom, and funding? As crazy as it is, the answer seems to be, well, yes. And it all came crashing down on launch day. The massive 80GB game made even the hardest of hard drives choke. People would boot up the game just to have it crash the computer after the intro cutscene.
What?
And even if they used their hacker skills to get past the crash, the game would still find a way to halt or erase their progress anyways. And Steel Wool's response to this broken launch? Well, they were just tired. And they would just fix the game later. And like I said, even after launch, things just wouldn't get better. After launch, they released a day one patch about a week later, which at least succeeded in allowing the game to boot for some people. And even if people managed to finish the game, the emotional endings were leaving people laughing if they had any reaction at all. Many of the bugs, such as the broken AI and lighting, wouldn't really be addressed until almost 6 months later. A few months after launch, an Xbox One port of the game got a trailer a few months after launch, then took an additional 6 months to release. And even to this day, Security Breach is still in pretty piss poor shape. It's just that the game actually kinda works now. But as As a wise man once said, even if it is a lot better, it still runs like shit, and is chock full of bugs. And like I said earlier, not only were a ton of features cut, the game was also significantly overhauled just 6 months before release, and that's why the trailers are so different from the game. I really believe the original premise of this game was to be a 2-hour long, Majora's Mask style 3D adaptation of the FNAF formula. What that hypothetical game may have lacked in length would have been made up for in replayability, and probably had a number of optional quests and consequential alternate ending, much like the classic FNAF games. However, as we all know, Steelwell having to deal with a large amount of scope creep and negligent managing resulted in an absolutely enormous pizzaplex, which we know for a fact grew from an originally planned 3 floors to 7. This would have resulted in the time system no longer being conducive, as the pizzaplex was simply too big for a player to reasonably play through over and over again, and thus, the game was revamped to be quest-based, with the hourly system simply being arbitrary now. With Steelwell attempting to reuse the time-based gameplay system, the now cut survival mode, I believe all of this would have happened in around the spring or summer of 2021, and I think that's why Steelwell brought on a new creative director so late in development, just to help them out with the new direction of the game. And of course, due to the aforementioned factors, the game underwent some massive changes in the creative department as well. And coupled with the overall massive overhaul of the game, were the technical challenges associated. I imagine that much of the base code and lighting would just simply be unable to handle the now massive scale of the game, and thus, one could argue the game just never got out of its beta stage. With Steelwell building the core game to be just functional enough, and simply deciding to fix the technical issues later after release, we see just how well that worked out in the end. But now, with that out of the way, I think it's time to discuss the story in a bit more depth. Alright, before we get started, here's a basic rundown of the original game series for all you who don't know. Showbiz pizza-style restaurant opens. Co-founder William Afton, who's a psychopath pedophile, uses it as a cover to murder children. The place is now haunted by some of the kids he killed. Chaos ensues. Now, I get it. There are obviously lots of nicks and niggles we didn't cover. But that's the basic premise. And make no mistake, this is an incredible story. That's a straight-up tragedy about lost souls, grief, and human suffering. Not to mention the fact that until the fifth game, it was grounded enough that people actually thought that it was based on a true story. Even with a handful of silliness coming after the fifth game, the wickedly well-woven story, crazy good characters, and awesome balance between coolness and believability really kept the franchise a masterpiece overall.
But now, I present to you Security Breach.
Of Dead Speak, in an abrupt, rushed, and buggy final, the voice of our most favorite Peter William Afton, whose very demise was central to one of the most conclusive and impactful video game endings in history, is heard throughout the galaxy. Fighting through all the retcons, short jumping, and unknowing red herrings, our heroes set out to set a stop to Afton's nefarious plans before he gets resurrected for a fifth time.
Somehow Afton returned.
The dark side of
shitty writing
is a pathway to many abilities some consider to be unnatural. Kill the
boy!
I never wanted you dead. I wanted you here.
Okay, maybe that was a bit too generalistic too. So here's a slightly more in-depth, but still very rough rundown of the story as we know it so far. After the FNAF 6 ending, some crazy rich unknown entity revives the Fazbear Entertainment brand and decides to build a multi-billion dollar theme park mall. Why, you might ask? Get this, to revive the dead William Afton for some fucking reason. Also, all the animatronics inside are flat out sapient for some reason. Are they possessed? Are they just really advanced AI? Nobody knows at this point. But whatever, in this universe it seems like a normal thing or something. Oh, and did I mention that a whole bunch of the old lore might not be canon, but just made up for a series of in-universe FNAF games, which are also the literal real-life FNAF games too for some reason? Which parts? Why? Nobody knows. Oh, and before William died, he built a bunch of perfect robot replicas of his dead daughter Elizabeth, one for each major stage of her life. Robots who can eat breathe, bleed, heal, and apparently even have normal relations with real humans. However, apparently he just forgot to add a kill switch for when each new robot activates, so now we have an unknown number of Elizabeth androids running amok. Some are innocent, some are murderous, and one is Vanny, and one is Vanessa. Yeah. Oh, and by the way, Afton also totally built a robot clone of his dead son Evan, aka the crying child. Who the fuck is he? Most likely Gregory, or something. We don't fucking know. But anyways, so Vanny slash Vanessa slash whoever the fuck else there is literally rebuilding William Afton out of his charred scrap-trap parts, parts of Glamrock Bonnie, and presumably real human remains that they got from somewhere, and then somehow transferring a literal AI copy of Afton's consciousness that they somehow got from scanning old animatronic parts into a fucking VR game that infected Vanessa, who has somehow been taken over by the virus from playing FNAF VR, and then they transfer it into the mangled corpse suit thing, who is also apparently growing flesh through him for some reason. Well, I guess Afton wants to be a half-flesh, half-rotten bunny suit creature for some reason. Who the fuck wrote this shit? But yeah, after they get that done, I guess he really wants his robot son back. So Afton hacks all the animatronics in the pizzaplex to go retrieve Gregory from upstairs. Why is Gregory upstairs again? Why doesn't he know about his dad? What the hell is Afton even trying to accomplish here exactly? Say it again with me, folks. Nobody fucking knows. But anyways, the game starts out with Glamrock Freddy almost getting taken over by the glitch trap virus to hunt Gregory, but he literally runs out of RAM and crashes for some reason. Then, Gregory somehow manages to slip inside his chest cavity, and they become real pals, with Freddy desperately trying to keep him alive until the place opens again in the morning so that Gregory can run back to that box he lives in down the block. Dumbass. Cue a bunch of mayhem and Gregory trashing all the animatronics up until morning finally arrives. Oh, and Vanny and Vanessa were there too, I guess. But anyways, cue a bunch of super cartoony and unfinished endings until you look up a walkthrough and go down to basement number 12 or something and find Afton Madoodle. And then he tries to kill you or grab you or something while hacking Freddy, who is suddenly not immune to his effects anymore despite being booted up in safe mode. Cue crazy unfinished cheesy boss battle and you burn down the pizzaplex while suddenly Afton gets taken away by not molten Freddy McRed Herring over here, who is just a blob of parts who was literally brought to life by the pain and suffering of Afton's past victims. That's it. Literal emotion can bring shit to life in this universe. I'm fucking done. Then Gregbot and sexy voice for fatherless children go off into the sunset. Until this moment inevitably gets retconned for the DLC, and Afton magically fuses with the blob to make an underwhelming tentacle monster boss. Roll credits. Ah, fuck. Now I gotta do the whole boss over again. Yep. Even if half this story is wrong, the other half gets explained, and yet another half gets retconned due to the backlash, we'll still have a laughable clusterfuck of a story here. This story isn't just absurd, it's stupidly absurd. And month after month, theory after theory, people are slowly having to come to terms with the fact that FNAF's lore has absolutely rotted to historical degrees. It's hilarious, because people get so damn salty talking about this game's lore, but slowly but surely, everybody is passing through the five stages of grief and making it to the other side. And going back to an earlier point, this game really is just a giant fanfiction. Again, the vision that Steelwool has for this game is a bit of a paradox. It's like this strange mixture of an outsider's understanding of FNAF and an insider's. It's clear that they know just how FNAF ticks, but yet they seem to either forget it or intentionally ignore it, and instead replace it with the vision of a sugar-high 14-year-old FNAF fan from 2014. And it feels kinda surreal, really. Really, I think this game is the epitome of don't give the fans what they want, give them what they really need. It's funny because they presented all this crowd-pleasy stuff and the people absolutely loved it. That is, until they actually got it, now Steelwool's like, oops, well they hated it, I wonder why. Now obviously, like all business mottos, this is a flawed philosophy. Everything is conditional in that world. Sometimes what the fans want is what they need. And sometimes, doing what the fans want is just gonna lead to disaster. But honestly, it's painfully obvious what Steelwool's strategy was here. They really wanted to set up the next 7 or 8 years of FNAF storytelling. But the problem is, instead of being deep or mysterious, they just settled for being vague and intentionally confusing. It's pretty clear they went like,
Guys, the fans have figured out 95% of the lore or something, we gotta set the next 8 years of mystery or something.
Oh, I know.
How about we, retcon all the game lore and stuff to be just, urban legends, and then put in some seemingly contradictory shit. That way everybody's just questioning if anything was really real and shit. And bada bang, bada boom, we got another 8 years of head scratching. Now, obviously something that has been crucial to this franchise has been its mystery. The original FNAF series did this by carefully setting up and progressively evolving plot lines. The cool thing about the lore was that it was never too difficult to set up a FNAF timeline, but it was nearly impossible to make one that neatly fit in all the information that we knew. Security Breach just says, pfft, screw that, and just doesn't explain jack shit. It's really annoying to me because I just know we're gonna be dissecting this awful lore for years now. Building lore has always been a challenge for media, especially franchises that revolve around mystery. Sister Location, for example, did this almost flawlessly by having a ton of concrete story, and also having a ton of unknown variables too. But most importantly of all, it still has the rule of cool to keep it afloat, even when the story gets a little silly at times. Security Breach is just when every flaw of the new era of FNAF just came crashing down in hilarious fashion. With Security Breach, the rule of cool just simply wasn't there to save it. And I cannot put enough emphasis on the fact that this is a new thing for the franchise. The problem with FNAF lore isn't that it's grown too big or too convoluted, or even that the seat of your pants approach Scott took with creating the story failed in the long term. Trust me, I've seen plenty of examples of that exact kind of storytelling failing, and this just wasn't one of them. For FNAF, the problem is simply that the lore has just gotten worse in quality. And as a long-term FNAF fan, I can comfortably say that FNAF's lore is easily the clearest it's ever been. Just about every nook and cranny, character, motivation, and location has been revealed and explained pretty damn well. I guess in a nutshell, I'm just trying to say that the lore's disorderliness has always been mistaken for convolution or just flat-out nonsense. And that's just the price a mystery game has to play. And even as a franchise has exploded in size, for every new concept it introduces, it explains four others. The problem is that ever since the Twisted Ones, almost all of these new concepts have been laughably absurd. For FNAF, it's really not that we don't have the answers we're looking for. It's just most of the time they're so damn bad that we're just trying our best to pretend they don't exist. And of course, Security Breach just adds in another fold to this by being vague and empty. If I haven't made it clear already, I had a huge amount of problems with FNAF before Security Breach came out, and I fully expected this game to be a dumpster fire lore-wise. But oh boy, I really just thought that I was pulling that idea out of my ass, not speaking prophecy. It is really interesting how I went from the odd one out among FNAF fans to just pretty much an average opinion. This game was obviously just so damn bad that it almost whipped some sense into much of the fandom, I think. And the funny thing is, after a game so botched, you'd really expect a massive fandom exodus. But surprisingly, FNAF is bigger than it ever was before. Even with most of the older fans walking back and out of this dumpster fire, the raw amount of interest a game this big and flashy brought to the franchise was nothing short of spectacular. And on a side note, turns out it also quite shockingly got a lot of older people interested in the franchise for the first time. And I mean like 30 to 40 year olds. But unfortunately, they kind of walked into a live dumpster fire and quickly lost interest. And yeah, so did the older fans really. When Security Breach first launched, it was pretty crazy how the average FNAF fan's age seemed to shoot up by 10 years, with the quality of thought and writing just exponentially increasing wherever you looked outside of TikTok. But if you look at the FNAF community today, it's overwhelmingly young kids and newcomers all over again, often a mix of both. The only exceptions to this are really the modelers and fan game devs. But even then, that makes a ton of sense, since for them, FNAF is whatever they want it to be. But of course, the fact that the franchise's biggest release motivated all the older fans to come back, then pissed them off so badly that they just left again, is neither here nor there. Another thing I commonly see is people trying to scapegoat the FNAF books at this point for most of the lore's problems. And to be perfectly fair, they are where most of the silliness happens. And make no mistake, I used to think that the books were the problem here too, and that dissecting the parallels was just too confusing and unnecessary. But now, I realize that concept is pretty friggin' genius. I mean, think about it. Just how much would we know about FNAF if it weren't for the books doing exactly that? But that's a topic for a whole nother video. No, I think the problem with FNAF's story is just the story itself. At this point, the only thing that separates a metric butt-ton of story concepts from the book lore from entering the game lore is just the raw absurdity of them. And now, that line of absurdity is thinning at an alarming rate. Enter MatPat. Yeah, at this point, the FNAF community's response to MatPat has just evolved into salt. MatPat may be a bit of a spectacle when it comes to most things, but for FNAF, people are just upset at the state of the lore, and are trying to give it the benefit of the doubt,
even when it's not exactly rational. People have been giving MatPat just so much shit for just how batshit insane his newer theories are. But let's face it, you gotta give it to good old MatPat, because without him, basically none of Security Breach's story would have been solved, and hardly anyone would have cared to try either. Let's be real here. MatPat hates the direction FNAF has been going on more than anyone, and yet he still managed to keep piecing it all together. He may be wrong about some things, but he's more than transparent about it all, and people really need to stop blaming him for all of this. If you're gonna hate on MatPat, hate on him for the stuff that he does wrong, not the shit that he actually gets right. And perhaps the hardest part about all of this is that this wasn't a group of ignorant studio execs writing out this mess of a story. This was Scott and Steel Wool. We know for a fact that Scott was still the story lead when Security Breach was released, and he is the brains behind Help Wanted as well. When it comes to the story, sure, you can make the argument that Scott kinda had to haphazardly cram it all around the gameplay concept Steel Wool was making, but all in all, this was still Scott's story, and him having to fit it to the gameplay only accounts for like 5% of the story's problems anyways. Let's be real here, Scott created the premise for this game, he created the backstory, and he most definitely was a massive contributor to the game's canon ending. Oh, and about that canon ending. Oh, that canon ending.
I don't see how things will ever be the same again. Short of brainwashing them.
But of course! How to brainwash children! Oh.
That's it?
The thing is, with Security Breach's canon ending, it's very obvious they were just trying to go for a holy shit, everything we knew was a lie type reveal, where they expected our brains to melt for a moment, and then for us to kinda see through the red herrings upon closer scrutiny. Which we did. However, the whole thing was just very poorly executed. In concept, the red herrings are great. You see that giant creature who looks like Molten Freddy? That's not actually him. That's just a blob of agony in a Funtime Freddy mask stolen from the museum. You see the guy who looks just like Springtrap? Well, if you look closely, you could see that it's just Glitchtrap, downloaded into a new hodgepodge body with some of his old parts. The big problem is, this whole thing ended up being very confusing. And red herrings aside, the whole premise was still pretty damn terrible. Scott and Steel Wool obviously thought that people would be more excited by the whole "everything we knew was a lie" trope, when really the whole thing was just so ham-fisted and poorly retconned in that everybody's lingering question was simply, why? Why would they do this? Steel Wool obviously expected people's reactions at this ending would be shock, then awe, then excitement. Then when people started to realize in their head that this didn't make sense, they would see that this was all a red herring and it'd be kind of this slow clap moment from the audience about how they'd been fooled by such a beautiful twist. When in reality, the audience reaction toward this ending was more like confusion, then disappointment, then a sort of cold apathy towards this whole thing. I mean, I'm really glad this isn't a full retcon of the FNAF 6 ending, but it just makes the lore so unnecessarily silly, contrived, and pointless. Now the five kids and Henry must be all facepalming in heaven over this guy coming back. And honestly, that's barely scratching the surface here. Unfortunately, Afton's return in Security Breach will never be a good thing. I'm sure they can patch all around it, maybe do some decent stories that they never would have been able to do without it, but it will always be putting lipstick on a pig. No matter how worth it may become, it will never actually be. And ultimately, every Afton return since FNAF 6 has felt like a misguided attempt to reconcile the "he always comes back" line from the FNAF 3 trailer, each nothing more than a creative midrash at the expense of the rest of the franchise. William Afton has really gone from a genre-defining character to just a cartoony gimmick, only appearing in the story to present his wacky, implausible plans and inventions, and to get blown up at the end of each episode, always returning in the next one, regardless if it makes any sense. And funny enough, I think the best description of the cartoony degradation of this character isn't the burn trap sequence, but rather his first appearance in the Twisted Ones. Now, that whole ordeal needs a fair bit of context, so I'll just leave the relevant bits here. But just know that after a quite frankly amazing horror sequence inside a sister location like Pizzeria, the gang is now cornered by the monstrous twisted animatronics, with Charlie finally losing her mind, and just begging why. Why do they want to do this to her? And then suddenly, out of the shadows comes a voice, and then... yeah... yep, I cannot make this up. This is all real. At this point, Afton's new motives really started to feel less like a clever subversion of the rules of the FNAF world, and more like a desperate attempt to convince the audience that he just wasn't a child predator. And adding to that, Springtrap really was a payoff more than a character evolution to Afton. He served as the bitter end to Afton's arc. But yet, FNAF just keeps trying to use him as a new character. Now, I'm sure many of you are thinking, what about Springtrap coming back for FNAF 6? Why doesn't that count? Well, for starters, his survival was very much premeditated by FNAF 3. Hell, it even constituted its own ending. And even that aside, Springtrap's return was more than worth it to the lore. Not only did it 100% tie up the loose ends of FNAF 3, but it was also essential to FNAF 6's sense of finality. Everyone was there, just as Henry planned. It was just as satisfying to see Afton finally burn as it was to see Baby and the puppet be set free. Henry got his revenge and freed the soul of his daughter and all the innocents still trapped. And perhaps the best part is that FNAF 6, rather flawlessly, makes both of FNAF 3 endings canon. And I know Scott did this very much on purpose. Just look at how he implies in the 2019 Doku interview that the canonicity of FNAF 3's endings are a bit more complicated than just an exclusive good or bad ending.
Which ending really happened?
I've given a lot of thought as to whether or not I should answer this question.
Okay.
And I went back and forth and back and forth and back and forth. And the answer is very interesting.
Okay. You know?
The answer is very interesting. The answer is complex.
Okay.
However, I'm not going to answer it because because it's only going to cause strife. I mean, you see the kind of trouble that erupts, especially several years ago, the flame wars that would go on over Mangle's gender, something as simple as that, you know.
yeah.
You know, I mean, you know, people with torches and pitchforks, you know. I don't think I'm going to answer this one, I'm afraid.
Let me explain. For FNAF 6, it starts off with the bad ending of FNAF 3. Springtrap survives the fire, and the souls of the children do not find peace. Thus, happiest day doesn't happen. Yet. In the canon insanity ending of FNAF 6, Henry deliberately makes a point to finish the job Michael was unable to succeed at in FNAF 3. And then some. Not only does he burn Afton, finally giving the souls peace, but he also takes down Baby, the Fun Times, Ballora, the Puppet, and Michael, who are the other remaining supernatural tragedies of the whole story. Now, obviously, there's some added nicks and niggles in there, like how the original five children have been soft retconned to possess Funtime Freddy, and how they and the puppet probably would have been set free regardless as long as Afton was finally burned. But that doesn't really matter here, because Henry wouldn't have had a way to know that anyways. And even if he did, he probably would have burned them anyways just to make sure. And thus, with the souls now free from the cruel metal, the puppet goes and consoles them, just as she consoled them after their very death, and convinces them that it's finally time to move on. And thus, happiest day finally occurs, and nearly all of the impact FNAF had with its endings is preserved. Bravo, Scott. Bravo. And even then, with perhaps the greatest video game finale in history, FNAF 6's standalone expansion, Ultimate Customite, still managed to add more to the story, while taking away none. Ultimate Custom Night was a brilliant sort of epilogue slash final twist to the series, and showed the one fatal flaw with Henry's plan in its most critical moment, Golden Freddy, the one spirit unaccounted for. And while yes, the souls of Evan and Cassidy find peace and happiest day, Cassidy takes the longest, and almost thwarts Henry's plan entirely. Just as the fire begins to rage on, the spirit of Cassidy swoops in and decides not to let Afton move on, keeping Afton alive in a perpetual state of nightmares, a hell of his own making as a revenge for the suffering she endured at his hands. But eventually, after being consoled by the fascinating figure of Old Man Consequences, she decides to leave Afton to his own demons, and joins the puppet in moving on. And thus, like the very souls of the innocents lost, the last of Scott's good writing finally passes on. But in all seriousness here, these were incredible endings. And now, to be perfectly fair, even though there are many, many problems with this game and its gameplay, one has to acknowledge that Steel Wool was kind of in a losing position to begin with. Because if there's one thing that the FNAF fanbase loves,
besides miners,
it's being very sameable. And if I'm gonna be perfectly honest here, the FNAF fanbase isn't a very normal gaming audience, if you will. Because, and I truly mean this with no offense, the vast majority of the fanbase has never really played a game outside of Minecraft, Roblox, or Brawl Stars. Boing, boing, boing. And while that's perfectly fine, it does make it a little harder to make a game for this kind of audience, as many of them aren't even familiar with basic gameplay styles or traditions. And this leads to a lot of interesting takes on Security Breach's gameplay online. Common sentiments I tend to see about the gameplay online tends to include comments that say that Security Breach is just a quote walking simulator filled with quote pointless fetch quests. And while I understand that many people simply say this to tell me that the game feels shallow, many others are being genuine. Again, you've heard me go into depth about the problems with the gameplay for this installment. You can really deconstruct any game like that. Mario is just a pointless jumping simulator where you have to run back and forth just to touch a flag. Metal Gear is just pointless stealth in a walking simulator. Doom is just pointless shooting and QuickTime events. And so on and so forth. Again, what I'm really trying to say here is that anything less than an extremely simple or casual gaming experience really seems to confuse most of the FNAF fandom. And in addition to that, as someone who's been in the hardcore fandom since basically day one, I really have to report that the FNAF fanbase is, like I said, a very sameable fandom. What does that mean exactly? Well, what do Call of Duty, FIFA, NBA 2K, and even Metroid fans have in common? Well, it's that the vast majority of the game's audience simply does not want any major gameplay changes compared to the original. And the FNAF fandom is no different. There's a joke among some of the Fnaftuber community that the fandom is always super excited for changes to the main formula, but always then hates them when they're actually made. And historically, this has rung painfully true. The harsh truth I'm getting at is, there's a sizable portion of the FNAF fanbase that hates Security Breach's gameplay for the sole reason that you're not in an office opening and closing doors for the whole game. And unfortunately, these people will probably dislike any installment in the future for that very reason. For the upteenth time, I'm not saying there's not major, major problems with Security Breach's gameplay, but I do have to sympathize for Steel Wool just a little bit. Because while the story, characters, and cutesy aesthetic of the game were all obviously meant to be crowd pleasers, they were really trying to make a deep and innovative AAA gaming experience. And even if they had actually succeeded in their mission, and I do mean if, still probably would have gotten a lot of unfair pushback about it all anyways. And I know, that one last point will undoubtedly be used obsessively by the fandom to white knight over Steel Wool for years to come. But people taking what I said out of context aside, I still feel like it's an important thing to be said. And let's be real for a moment here. While Steel Wool was responsible for the game itself being the giant mess it is, Scott was the one responsible for just about everything else. You can easily see why Scott considers this whole thing to be so stressful. You just gotta see it from Scott's perspective. Just 8 years ago, he was just a 40-something-year-old cashier living out in the countryside. I think Security Breach and especially its upcoming DLC Ruin are perfect examples of whatever's going on with Scott here. He wants to do something bright and crowd-pleasy, but at the same time wants to stay with FNAF's horror roots. And he also wants to stick with the old lore that fans love so much. But he also wants to tell his own crazy story with its own crazy logic now, just like in the books. But he knows that most fans hate the lore and story of the books. But at the same time, he doesn't want to appeal to those who dislike that approach. He just wants to appeal to the fans who do love whatever he's making. I'm gonna say it here and I'll probably say it again. There is no reason to continue Security Breach past the DLC. The game was and still is abundantly satisfying to the new fans, and the once insanely sequel ravenous old fans just have no interest in this iteration continuing. The only part of Security Breach the old fans still, quote, care about is getting answers to the mind-numbingly absurd, convoluted, and pretty much nonsensical lore presented in that game. And as crazy as it may sound, the vast majority of new Security Breach fans just couldn't give a damn about the lore at all. I think the path forward for FNAF is pretty straightforward at this point. You just gotta tie up the loose ends with Security Breach Ruin, make some more Security Breach books and merchandise for the new fans, and then just move on with whatever other games are being developed for the franchise. It's okay, you made a game that a lot of people enjoyed, made a ton of money, learned a lot of lessons, and best of all, actually somehow got the world to like FNAF again. Even if most of that newfound admiration didn't extend to this game in particular. This game really was an amazing atrocity, and an awful masterpiece. And I will admit, with all emphasis, I wouldn't be at all surprised if Security Breach Ruin was an amazing DLC. And looking at the changes that Steel Wool has made internally, I wouldn't be surprised if Steel Wool finally becomes the AAA studio it has always dreamed of being. But all in all, a bad story is still a bad story. I think that most of us would much, much rather have that talent put to something good, rather than trying to patch over something bad. Anyways, this is Shycro, signing off.